The world's sea levels are rising, and it will affect many people's lives. But it is those living on the low-lying atoll island nations of the Pacific and Indian Oceans who arguably face the most significant disruption. Occasionally, we hear that the rising seas will overwhelm and drown these islands, forcing people to flee to new lands. Do rising seas really mean sinking islands? The evidence doesn't seem to say so, but that doesn't mean that everything will be all right. So what is an atoll? Most definitions commonly include two things. First, there has to be a coral reef rim, and second, that reef has to either totally or partially surround a shallow central lagoon. Most atolls are located in the tropical areas of either the Indian and Pacific Oceans. Where did they come from? Charles Darwin proposed a theory during his trip around the world on the HMS Beagle. While observing the Cocos Islands in 1836, he theorized that they largely begin as reefs surrounding a volcano island. Over time, the volcano goes extinct and erodes away, leaving behind the reef and the central lagoon. This theory is interesting, cute as a button, and remains in a few textbooks. However, it does not explain the origins of most atolls. So in recent years, a second theory has emerged. It is known that sea levels rise and fall throughout the eras for natural reasons. When sea levels drop, they can expose these flat-topped structures made from carbonate rocks. Their origin can either be volcanic or non-volcanic. Rain then accumulates on those rocks, pooling in the middle. Since rain is mildly acidic, it can, over time, dissolve the limestone rocks at the center. This is how certain landscapes, like springs or caves, are made. They call this process karst. So in this theory, karst is what creates these bowl-shaped rims. Then after 100,000 years or so, the sea levels rise once again, submerging the rimmed structure. The rocky rims, being closer to the sun, become the ideal platform for new corals, and there you have it, a pretty nifty theory. So how do the islands on top of the atolls come about? UV lithography. Just kidding. Waves. Waves deposit loosely held together sediment onto those shores until they eventually poke up above the waterline. The sediments have multiple sources, most of which are biological. Some come directly from coral reefs, so either being the skeletal remains of corals or pieces of the reefs, broken off by waves or impact. Another major source are organisms who grind up rock and coral to get to their food, like sea urchins or parrotfish. Parrotfish, for instance, bite and grind corals with their teeth and play an unexpectedly large role in sand generation. In some areas, parrotfish generate up to 90% of a reef's sand. Gradually, you get these long, narrow strips of low-lying land forming on top of the atolls. And then plants find their way to this land. Their presence is essential, not only because they create a layer of soil that helps support other life, but also because their roots can hold together the sand and keep it from being eroded and washed away. These atoll islands are almost always very low-lying. This is because sand can never pile up higher than the average height of the waves, so they generally do not rise more than 3 meters above the average sea level, 5 max. For example, about 80% of the 1,190 islands making up the Maldives are just a meter above sea level. Since these islands are so low, then what happens when the sea levels rise? As I mentioned, sea levels rise and fall throughout the years. Global climate change is perhaps responsible for some of this, but overall, the rise and its magnitude comes as a result of a complex interaction of various factors that also include shifting tectonic plates, sea current changes, volcanic events, water from melting ice caps, and the changing thermal expansion of the water itself. For the past 130 years, the seas have risen about an average of 200 millimeters in total across the whole globe. For most of the 20th century, this data was based on tide gauge records. Starting in 1993, we started using satellite measurements, and the satellite data shows an acceleration in annual sea level rise to about 3.3 millimeters a year. These numbers are global averages, so there are variations depending on geography, with certain areas like the Central and West Pacific areas rising faster. So rising seas and low-lying islands, does this mean that the islands sink beneath the waves and vanish? The weird thing is that there has been little evidence of these islands vanishing beneath or being washed away by the waves. In many cases, particularly those of the atoll islands of the Pacific, quite the opposite. A 2010 study of the Marshall Islands by Murray Ford compared aerial island photography starting from World War II and into the 1970s and 2010s. It found that between 1946 and 2010, the sea levels in the area have risen by an average of 2.2 to 3.7 millimeters per year. Despite this, over 80% of the islands' shorelines, as defined by the vegetation line, not the sand, either grew larger or saw no change. A 2017 study led by Mohammed Aslam compared present-day photographs of 184 islands in the Maldives with photographs taken in 1969. In aggregate, the islands' net land area increased by 59 hectares, or 2.4%. But this aggregate number hides much variation between the different islands. 77 saw some erosion, 36 added mass, in part due to land reclamation, which we will talk about later, and the remaining 71 were essentially stable. In 2019, there was a historical review of 709 atoll islands in the Indian and Pacific Oceans, the Atoll Island Database, maintained by Virginie Duvall of the University of La Rochelle CNRS. This review found that 73.1% of the islands stayed about the same size, 15.5% of them grew larger, and only 11.4% decreased in size. The smallest islands tended to be the most volatile. A 2024 study led by Paul Kench of the National University of Singapore, who has done a lot of this work of this type, reviewed 509 islands over the past 50 years and found similar results. 46.1% of the studied atoll islands have been stable in size, another 32.4% showed expansion, and only 21.4% contracted in size. And one particularly exceptional work done in 2021 by a team led by Mingyue Wu of the University of Miami studied 36 years of aerial photographs of a single uninhabited atoll chain in the Chagos Archipelago, Perros Bajos. Humans never settled this particular atoll, but they do inhabit a different nearby atoll, Diego Garcia, that happens to host one of the most secretive and strategically located American bases in the Indian Ocean. Anyway, Wu's work found that the island's net land size stayed virtually the same between 1979 and 2015 by percentage. This is despite a sea level rise of about 5.4 to 5.9 millimeters each year. So what is going on here? The issue is that we assume that these islands are static, unchanging pieces of land. Quite the opposite, as satellite photos show. As I briefly mentioned, these atoll island lands are created by coral reef sediments and biologically created sands deposited onto the shores by waves and surges. Rising sea levels make those waves higher and stronger, so in turn they deposit more coral sediments and sand onto the island's shores, and it grows the island shorelines largely faster than the sea can erode it away. Large swells, floods, or storms, when they happen, can do this too, either eroding or depositing yet more sand, depending on the island, reef, and shore's individual dynamics. This is particularly the case for smaller, more vulnerable islands. Another sign of these complicated dynamics at play can be seen in how extremely variable these individual shorelines are, with one side growing and the other shrinking. The Chagos Archipelago and Maldives Islands' work show this. Sometimes the shoreline changes are so much that the whole island might quote-unquote migrate, as in literally shift or even rotate in a certain direction. So the rising seas are not necessarily washing away the islands. That does not mean that the coast is clear. A key player in the islands' land buildup is the coral reefs surrounding them. If the coral reefs are somehow damaged or killed off, that eliminates a critical source of loose sediment for shore buildup. These coral reef bleaching events can happen for a variety of reasons, some of which we can trace to human activity. For example, warming and acidifying oceans, massive algae blooms, coastal dredging activities, and heat waves. Overfishing the coral reefs and releasing unclean sewage into the water can also affect the animal life surrounding the islands. Remember the parrotfish's important and underrated role in producing sand. Another major challenge that rising sea levels pose is flooding or inundation. Currently, sea levels are rising by about 3.2 to 4.2 millimeters each year. Assuming this trend continues and how it might accelerate, then by 2100, a year by which I hope myself and this channel will be closed and gone, the average sea level will be ranging anywhere from 0.26 to 0.97 meters higher, or worse. Higher sea levels mean higher waves, not only from cyclones and tropical storms, but also random swells. The latter already can get to as high as 5 meters. And by 2100, we project the highest one-third of such swells to be 5 to 10% higher in the South Pacific Ocean. Higher waves are more likely to break over the reefs and reach the shoreline. There, the water can do substantial damage to people's homes and infrastructure, particularly in urbanized areas. For example, a series of unusually strong tidal swells in the Maldives across 4 days in May 2007 led to 1,649 people being evacuated. Houses and schools were damaged, crops were ruined, and clean water was in shortage. But swells are not necessary for the seas to come. There are naturally occurring but nevertheless destructive high tides, fittingly called king tides. They can rise over 3 meters, bringing the water directly into people's homes. And of course, there are extreme weather events like tropical storms. Such cyclones can damage a tropical island so much that sometimes the whole population might decide to abandon it and move to the mainland. Yet at the same time, cyclones play an important role in depositing lots of sand onto the shores, creating new land. Nature takes and gives. About that clean water, many of these islands get most of their fresh water from something called a freshwater lens. The lens is a convex-shaped layer of fresh water that sits underneath the island and is separate from the salt water. It is recharged via more rain. As the name implies, the lens is very thin. Floods can breach the freshwater lens and raise its salinity level and make it undrinkable. Plumes of salt water from these floods can persist at the bottom of a water lens for months or even years after the flood. Several unusually strong floods in succession might even permanently impair the freshwater lens. I'll probably cover this in a future video. How do we mitigate these risks? This is where it gets complicated. The reality is that the natives have been living with their islands flooding and even moving around for a very long time. In the late 1890s, an Anglican missionary traveled to the Solomon Islands and recorded, "The islands are all built up to a height sufficient to keep out high spring tides, and the only danger of flooding is in December and January. At such times, it is not uncommon for the water to come into the houses, but this is part of the life and nobody minds." For islands that are not heavily settled or urbanized, perhaps the best thing to do would be to maintain the natural processes that produce and bring sand to the shores. And when the water comes, oh well, that is just part of life. But modern urbanized life, with its electronics and cars and things, is not very well suited for annual floods, which makes the people living in the cities built on these atoll islands uniquely vulnerable. And some of the measures they have employed to protect themselves also disrupt the natural processes of island formation. For example, the most common coastal erosion prevention measure in the Maldives or other urbanized islands is the seawall. They might be made from cement bags, coral mounds, steel, or boulders, and can be about 0.5 to 1 meter tall. But at the same time, seawalls are not only aesthetically ugly, but they also disrupt sand accumulation on island shores. In the Taku Atoll in Papua New Guinea, seawalls constructed in the 1970s are seen as being responsible for reducing the width of the sandy beach from 10 meters to 3. Similar cases in Kiribati. Since de-urbanization is not really an option now, what urbanized islands are doing more intensively is land raise and reclamation. In recent years, the Maldives has been experiencing growth thanks to their tourism economy. Population pressures have led to extensive land engineering due to land reclamation, where sand is dredged up from the sea bottom and deposited elsewhere. Studies of the country's 188 inhabited and resort islands have found that up to 93.5% of inhabited islands have experienced some sort of shoreline modification with reclaimed land. And since the 1970s, the capital city of Malé has been expanded some 33%, or half a square kilometer. In the late 1990s, it became no longer possible to expand Malé due to surrounding depth issues, so the government decided to create a brand new island called Huluhumale right next door. This was done by piling sand dredged up from the atoll on top of an adjacent coral reef. Phase 1 of the project started in 1997 and involved the initial land reclamation. It took about 5 years to complete and cost about $32 million in total. The first residents started moving there in 2004. Phase 2 began in 2015, and it would further expand the island and build new infrastructure on top of it. Then in 2018, a bridge was built connecting Hulahumale and Male, greatly helping the flow of population from one island to the other. A Phase 3 began in September 2023 with the goal of reclaiming another 63 hectares of land from the sea so that they can build housing and other public services to alleviate the ongoing housing crisis in Male City. Hulahumale was initially built 1.8 meters above sea level and is protected with large sheet metal walls in the north, west, and south. Being higher than its neighbor Male, it has yet to experience serious floods, but more seawalls and dikes are available in the future to repel them, if necessary. The Maldives' land reclamation campaigns have received some criticism for possibly exacerbating the factors that worsen sea level rise impacts down the line. For example, sand dredging damages coral reefs, which eliminates the natural sand generation process that built up the islands in the first place. But the perception within the Maldives has generally preferred hard engineering solutions, especially after the 2004 Indonesian tsunami, where armoring was perceived to have protected the capital city Male, as opposed to unprotected outer islands, which suffered more serious damage. The concern is that diving deeper into engineering solutions leads to a sole dependence on engineering, and down the line we run out of money, resources, or sand to make these engineering options practical. Alright everyone, that's it for tonight. Thanks for watching. Subscribe to the channel, sign up for the Patreon, and I'll see you guys next time.